those praises rising. Serve a glorious God tonight, amen. I said, how many know that we serve a glorious God tonight, amen? Let's put your hands together like this.
Shout it out, yeah, glory. give God some praise tonight. Hallelujah. We serve a glorious God, don't we, church? Oh, come on, we can do better than that this evening. We serve a glorious God this evening. Hallelujah. He deserves the glory. He deserves the honor. Amen. Hallelujah. Just lift those hands tonight. Hallelujah. And just worship him just for a few moments. Speak your love language to your heavenly Father tonight, because he wants to hear your voice. He wants to hear your worship. He wants to receive your worship to him tonight. Hallelujah. Oh God, we worship you. We worship you, oh God. You're worthy, Jesus. Oh, we give you glory, Lord. One voice you deserve.
You deserve the glory.
Yes, he does.
And the honor.
Lord, we lift.
Lord, we lift our hands in worship. As we lift your holy name.
Just lift those hands tonight. If you're able to lift those hands. In reverence to our heavenly Father.
And the honor. As we lift your
we sing, for you are great,
for you are.
Voices like we mean it. Praise the name of the Lord. Hallelujah, hallelujah, hallelujah. Oh, mighty King of kings and Lord of lords. Praise God. Praise God. Oh, mighty God. Mighty God. If you need a physical healing, just step out and make your way down here. We're going to lay hands on you. And we're going to believe God for the miracles that you need tonight. And Alan, would you stand in for someone tonight for me, please? Come down up here in front. I'm going to ask a whole bunch of men to gather around Alan and lay hands on him a little bit in behalf of Terry Laird's son. Okay, come on down close so we can get you separate from everybody else here, okay? We're going to pray for everyone, and after we've all prayed, I want you to stay up here after Mike prays, and then we're all going to gather around and lay hands on Alan. And the reason is Eric Laird, Terry Laird's son. Now, Terry is one of our police officers, has been here over about 25 years. He's Jackson County Sheriff. and his son was born with his heart reversed. And he did surgery when he was a boy, not expected to live, and God performed miracles. Well, he's been through 3 surgeries in the last 2 days. He's on the East Coast with a heart specialist. His heart was leaking, and they went in and replaced the valves, started leaking again the next day. Next day, they thought he was having a heart attack, and he was rushed back into surgery just before church tonight. So we're going to lay hands on Alan on behalf of Eric, okay, on behalf of Eric tonight, Eric Laird. And I want as many to come, lay hands on these other folks that are down here. If you need a physical healing, come on down. We're going to pray for everyone. But we're going to pray after we prayed for everyone else. We're going to pray for Eric Laird tonight. Praise God. Praise God. Let's believe God together. Can we sing that again, Pastor Nicole? Praise God. Oh, mighty God.
You are great. You do miracles.
Oh, mighty God.
Thank you that that heart is new in the name of Jesus. We thank you, Lord, that the resurrection power of Jesus is available today to us by faith in the mighty name of the living God. And we command that heart to go right back into place. We command it to start beating right. We command it not to leak. We command it to do what it's supposed to do in the mighty name of Jesus. And God, we thank you that in this house right now, the miracles and the signs and the wonders that you're going to do because of the resurrection Christ, because that tomb is empty, because Jesus is seated at the right hand of God, because God has done it all for us in Christ Jesus. Sickness is made whole. Cancer, you got to go back where you came from. Diabetes, you got to go back where you came from. We thank you for the authority given us in Christ Jesus. We command you, sickness, to go back where you came from. We command deliverance and setting free of the captives in Jesus' mighty name. And everyone that loves the Lord said, amen.
Pastor Nicole and the praise team and the musicians tonight. Praise God. Turn around, greet 4 or 5 people, let them know God loves them, cares about them, knows them by name, knows everything about them, and loves them anyway. No, I think that's all right. Yeah, yeah. Praise God. I almost got knocked over when I touched you. Praise God. Oh, mighty Lord Jesus. Praise God. Oh, wow. Praise God. Before you go to bed tonight, remember Eric Laird. And he's in his early 20s now. And usually when you have that condition, you don't live to be more than 4 or 5 years old. So he's already a miracle, but let's ask God to finish what he started. And we've seen God do it before. We had a lady here several years ago across the street. And a week before her baby was to be born, the doctor said, it's dead. We want to take him out. He's dead. She said, no, I'm going to believe God. The baby was born perfect. God's still a miracle working God. Folks. Still a miracle working God. We had a situation like that up in Michigan back years ago. That's about the time Noah built the ark, when Pastor George was born. That's how long ago it was. And we had a young couple in the church. They were kind of on the fence spiritually. And their first baby was born stillborn. And the second baby was on the way. And the doctor said, there's something wrong. We don't know what else. They didn't have all the good tests they have now. Doctor said, there's something wrong. This baby will not survive. And I got mad at God. How many ever get mad at God? I got in the church and I screamed at God, haven't they had enough? Haven't they had enough? I know you love them, perform a miracle. And God said, you're going to see what this does. And during the next few months, they became the spiritual leaders of that church. They got that close to God, and that baby was born perfect. Okay. And if we get to it, we're going to talk about tests and trials tonight in Romans. Remember, Sunday is Resurrection Day. How many have already invited someone to come Sunday? Shame on the rest of you. People will go to church on Easter Sunday that will never go another day of the year. And you might be their only chance of ever getting saved before Jesus comes. How many know someone that's not saved? How many know someone doesn't go to church? Bring them Sunday. Take them out for dinner if you have to, even if it's a Big Mac, whatever. And just take them out for dinner. I've got this new mic I'm trying, so I have to bear with us a little bit tonight. The announcements again, Resurrection Sunday. Everybody's going to be in the auditorium. No Sunday school, no nurseries. We're going to sit in here as family. And the water baptismal will be Sunday, April 3rd. Sunday, April 3rd, following the 11 o'clock service. Women at the Well Ministry will be showing the movie, Do You Believe? This Saturday, 11 a.m. at Sheffield West. Popcorn and water will be provided. So let me encourage you, if you want to see that movie, there's some good Christian movies out there. There's another one coming out, God Is Not Dead, number two. And the first one was really good, and the second one looks good, too. And it's amazing. It's actually produced by Christians, and it's really a good one, really a good one. There is a situation I heard about this week. There are two major organizations, because the big thing, now we got to pray about the Supreme Court. And we need to pray about our federal judges, too, because there are some people sitting on the bench that have no business sitting on the bench. Just read about them, that's all. But there's a whole movement now against, it isn't the word prejudice. For instance, they're trying to get the government to stop making student loans to Christian schools because they only let Christians in. Okay, they won't let people that aren't Christians in. And they have moral standards, and they won't let people in. So they're saying they're discriminating. That's the big word, discrimination. So they're trying to get any college that doesn't let anyone in for something like that to stop getting government funding for student loans and grants and all those kind of things. The enemy's moving, folks. We need to pray. We need to pray that God will break through in this country, and God will break through in the people that make these decisions. And we know the forces of hell and the forces of atheism are at work, and the enemy's out to ruin, kill, and destroy. But we win. I've read the back of the book. How many know we win? We win because he wins. He stands in Revelation 5, and John sees that scroll in God's hand. I saw in the hand of him that sat on the throne a book sealed with on the inside and sealed on the backside, and actually sealed with seven seals. And he heard an angel say, no man in heaven or earth is worthy to take the book and to loose the seals thereof. And John says, I wept much. Because no man in heaven or earth is worthy to take the book and loose the seals. Because John knew what this was. And quickly, it's a mortgage deed. In other words, man lost his inheritance in the Garden of Eden. Satan became the ruler of the cosmos, the ruler of the structured society. And if you mortgaged your property, you wrote down what would have to happen to get your property back. And on the back would be one name on the outside, your nearest relative. In case you couldn't pay your bill, he or she would be the only one that could open the book and see what had to be done to give you back your inheritance. And so John knows what this is. And he starts crying, and he hears one of the living ones say, "Stop your weeping, John. The author, the root, the lion of the tribe of Judah, the root and offspring of David, has prevailed to take the book and to loose the seals thereof." And I turned, and I saw lambs that had been slain, having seven eyes and seven horns, which are the seven spirits of God. And he walks over and takes the book out of the Father's hand. And you hear the great praise. You're worthy of praise, for you have redeemed us by your blood out of every kindred, tongue, tribe, and nation. And as our nearest relative, he starts opening the book in chapter 6 to show how we're going to get our inheritance back. And then in chapter 1, as our nearest relative, he puts one foot on the sea and one foot on the dry land and basically says, "I'm taking it back. No more time for sin. No more time for death. No more time for sorrow. No more time for pain." And the rest of Revelation is how Jesus is taking it back. We win because he wins. Praise God. And that was just a pick. That was just a quickie on Revelation. Remember all the services coming up Easter Sunday, 9 and 11 as always. And again, everyone will be in here. Invite somebody. Bring somebody. And how many know God wants everybody saved? Amen. Whose feet does he have but ours? Whose voice does he have but his people? Whose hands does he have but his people? The Lord laid it on my heart in the second service Sunday, interpretation of a prophecy that was given in tongues. And said, as long as he was in the world, he was the light of the world, but now you're the light of the world. And it's our responsibility to let his nature shine to everyone we come in contact with. And do people look at us and say, if that's a Christian, that's what I want to be. That's what he wants us to do. If you need a debit envelope, our ushers have debit envelopes, if you'll slip your hands up. And remember to pray for the service this Sunday for a mighty move of the Spirit of God. And if you want to help on my mission trips after the service, not in the regular offering, there's always a basket back there, and there's envelopes. And I'm actually scheduled for Myanmar, which is Burma, in July. And then I'm scheduled for Singapore at the end of August. And that's the only two trips I've got scheduled. But it takes a lot of money to do those trips. And as you know, when I go to Burma, they don't have any money at all. And so it's, and I made an amazing discovery today. I found out I could save $1,000 on airfare if I bought the ticket today. So I bought the ticket today, put it on my credit card. So it's, but if you want to help, don't take it out of anything else you're going to give to the church. It's a special mission offering on the back if you want to help on the way out. And if it's a check or anything or an envelope, just mark down for Dr. Westlake's mission trips. And I try to raise the extra money. The church will sponsor it anyway, but I try to raise it extra because our budget here is about half the budget of suburban churches. And so we need everyone's faithfulness here. So let God continue to bless you. How many find out you can't outgive God? Say a big amen.
Amen.
I'm going to ask the ushers to come. Father, we're thankful again we have the opportunity of being involved in the greatest work in time or eternity. Pray now as we offer these gifts out of hearts of love. Bless your people abundantly in Jesus' mighty name. And all God's people said,
amen.
Amen. Okay, I might need my mic cut just a little bit. Or maybe it's my hearing aids. You all know I got hearing aids last week. And I'm hearing sounds I forgot existed. I actually didn't know the turn signals on my car actually made a clicking noise. And I'm hearing all kinds of weird sounds. I'm going to cut the volume back on this and see if that helps. So, and I can work them from my iPhone. So there, I cut them way back. That sounds better. As I used to say when I was a kid, more betterer. Okay, we are in the third chapter of Romans. Now, we're probably going to move a little fast through a couple of these chapters. But any time there's a question, just go ahead and raise your hand or holler and jump and dap and down or scream or something. And we'll go on with the question. And please wait till you get the mic because I watched last Wednesday night on the internet. And the thing is, I couldn't hear most of the questions. So wait till you get the mic if you're going to ask a question. But we're actually starting on chapter 3. Is that where we were last week? Does everybody remember? Okay, starting on chapter 3. And he's asking a question then. He says, what advantage is there to being a Jew? And what prophecies are of circumcision? He's already said that the outward circumcision doesn't mean anything. The religious ritual doesn't mean anything unless you're living by faith. And what advantage is there? Much in every way. Number one, we're committed unto them the oracles of God. That's the Old Testament, the law, the prophets, the Psalms. All of the Old Testament, the oracles of God. And then he says, for what if some didn't believe? So what? In other words, shall their unbelief make the faith of God without effect? Not everyone accepts God's truth. You know, the fact that people don't believe in Jesus today, does that mean it's not true?
That's right.
No. That's what he's saying about the Old Testament. Now, my King James Bible says, God forgive. Paul says, be it not so. I don't know why they translate it, God forbid, but the Greek text says, be it not so. Let God be true and every man a liar. You know, when God promises something, it's going to happen. It's going to happen. Every man a liar, that you might be justified in your saying and might overcome when you're judged. Now, he's actually referring to God here. And he's actually quoting the 51st Psalm, which is David's prayer of repentance. And he's quoting it from the Greek translation of the Old Testament. And he's actually saying this. David said, God, I have sinned, and you're righteous in judging me. The fact that you judge me means that you're righteous. You're not just overlooking my sin. David, if you want to read his prayer after he committed adultery and murder, it's Psalm 51. And that's where this verse is taken from. And as Nathan the prophet said, yeah, God will forgive you, but you've given the enemies of the Lord a chance to blaspheme. As you might be justified in your sayings and overcome when you're just. That's referring to God. God is righteous when he judges, but God is also righteous when he forgives. Amen. And the question is, how can a holy God forgive George Westlake all the dumb, stupid things I've done? How many of you have done a bunch of dumb, stupid things too? Say, all right. And how can a holy God forgive me? How can he do that? How can he possibly do it? And then he says this, if our unrighteousness commends the righteousness of God. In other words, well, I'm so rotten it makes God look good because he's holy. What shall we say? Is God unrighteous who takes vengeance? I speak as a man from a man's viewpoint. Be it not so, for how shall God judge the world? For if the truth, what about if the truth of God is overabounded through my lie unto his glory? So if I get up and give a great testimony, boy, look what God did for me and it's not true, and you all glorify God. He says, I'm yet judged as a sinner. Why? Because I'm lying. Lying is a sin. How many are aware of that? Amen. Have you ever heard anyone say, well, I don't go to church, but I keep the Ten Commandments? Well, they just broke one of them. They're lying. Right? Only one person ever lived that kept the Ten Commandments. As I tell you every week, I don't know why they call it the good book. There's only one good person in it. Everybody else is just like us. Everybody, aren't you glad they're in there? Well, you know, what if Jesus was the only one? We'd all give up. How should God, for the truth of God, why am I led to judge the sinner? Not rather as we be blasphemously reported, is what the Greek text says. And as some affirm, we're saying, let's do evil that good may come as a result. Our judgment is righteous. Now he's going to sum it up. He's talked in chapter 1, he calls in creation. Creation says you should have looked at me and known there's a God. Then he calls in man's conscience or the moral law or the Noahic law that God has put in every human being. When you're born as a child, you know what's right and wrong. All right? How the Bible talks about a conscience being branded with a hot iron. And in those days, only criminals and thieves were branded. And a criminal thinks they have the right to take anything or do anything they want. Okay? And then a slave was branded. And a slave says, well, I just can't help myself. That's the way I am. Well, how many know he came to change the way we am? All right? So it's called creation and conscience, and he's called the law. Okay, the law of Moses with the Ten Commandments. And all three of these witnesses are going to say guilty, 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 guilty. Now, he's going to quote 14 scriptures, most of them from the Psalms, one from the book of Isaiah. And he's going to quote 14 scriptures from the Old Testament to show the law condemns and says we are all guilty. So this is the turning point in this chapter. It's like a prosecuting attorney. You've heard all the evidence. He's called on creation. He's called on the conscience. He's called on the law. And I can just picture him walking up and down in God's courtroom, and he's going to quote these 14 things. This is called a catena. Okay, it's a catena because it's a whole list of scriptures. Starts out in verse 10. There is none righteous, no, not one. There is none that understand. There are none that seek after God. They are all gone out of the way. They are together become unprofitable. And I like that word unprofitable. It's the same word for sour milk. Wow. There is none that is practicing good, not even up to one. Their throat is an open sepulcher. Now, an open sepulcher means an open grave with a stinking body in it. An open sepulcher, their throat, their tongues they have used to seek. The poison of serpents is under their lips. How many like me had to learn to talk after you got saved? And I've told you the story before. I actually started smoking when I was 8 years old. Okay, and my dad, being a warehouse foreman, would get cigars. A baby's been born. Well, my buddy and I would skip school and smoke cigars. And I inhaled them. And then I started smoking a pipe when I thought I was a big dude. And the last thing I did at night was put my pipe in the rack. When I was 19 years old, first thing I did in the morning, I'd light it up. And I thought, boy, I'm a good dude. Well, then I got saved. I quit smoking the same night, but I had to learn to talk. Had to learn to straighten out my language. As you know, I grew up in Detroit, all right? And it wasn't a good part of Detroit. So if you didn't curse on the way to school and on the way home, you'd get beat up. So you had to be part of the group. And so a good Baptist brother told me you need a Thompson Chain Bible, and that's what I have here. It's called the Thompson Chain Bible. And it was a transportation strike in Detroit, and I found a store way over on the east side that had them, and I hitchhiked across Detroit. And I walked to the store and said, I want a Thompson Chain Bible. They said, what's that? I said, but you told me on the phone you have one. Well, we don't. I got so mad, I went out of there. I used every four-letter word I'd ever used in my life. How many know some things take time to get the victory over? Some things happen instantly, but there's other things we have to battle. And so the thing, whatever you're battling, God can give you victory over it. And Paul's going to tell us how in Romans 6, 7, and 8. He's going to tell us how to have victory, how to live day by day by the power of God. Right now, he's just laying the foundation for why we need the Holy Spirit and why we need Jesus Christ in our life. Okay, their throat is an open sepulcher. The poison of serpents is under their lips. Their mouths are full of cursing and bitterness. Now their feet are swift to shed blood, destruction, and misery in their ways. The way of peace they have not known. There is no fear of God before their eyes. So he summed it up pretty good. Can you just picture him walking back and forth in God's courtroom, pointing the finger at us as the defendants? Now we know whatsoever the law says, that's the law of Moses, it says to those that are under the law, that every mouth may be stopped and all the world may become guilty before God. And then he makes a statement he's going to amplify in Romans 8. For by the deeds of the law shall no flesh be justified. He's going to argue that in chapter 7 and chapter 8. For the law is the knowledge of sin. What's the purpose of the law, Paul, if I can't keep it? And the book of Galatians says, in order to be saved by keeping law, you can't break one little part of it. So anyone that tells you they're saved by keeping the Ten Commandments, if they've broken one, they're a lawbreaker. How many have ever told a little itsy-bitsy lie? How many have ever told a big whopper? Raise your hand, or that's number two. All right? You've broken the commandments. How many have ever put yourself ahead of God? You've broken the commandment. I won't get into all 10 of them. How many of you always honored your mother and father when you were teenagers? And when I preach to teenagers, I tell none of you would survive if we were back in the Old Testament, but your parents wouldn't have survived either. Okay? So that every mouth may be stopped. The reason of God's law is to call sin, sin. Well, I'm just stretching the truth a bit. No, God's law says that's sin. Well, I'm just committing adultery. I'm just having sex with somebody that's not my spouse. It's just everybody's doing it. The law says it's sin. Law says it's sin. Well, I got a whole bunch of stuff I put ahead of God. The law says that's sin. We could go on and on. So the law is given to call sin, sin. It names it, tells us what it is. And God's word does that very well. Whatsoever the law says, it says to those who are under the law, every mouth may be stopped. Therefore, by the deeds of the law, shall no flesh be justified in his sight. Meaning no flesh can be declared not guilty by keeping the law. The word justify means to be rendered holy. And nobody can be rendered holy by keeping the law because you can't keep it. How many always never drive over 65 on I-70? How many always go 35 down Winter Road? And especially across the Armco Bridge when it's open. Why, you're a lawbreaker. And suppose you're driving 80 on the freeway and you see some green lights behind you, blue lights. They stop you and say, but I didn't rob a bank. But I didn't hurt anybody. No, but you still broke the law. And that's what Paul says and the Bible says about keeping the law and trying to be saved by keeping law. You cannot do it. It's not possible. It's not possible. You don't have the ability. For all have sinned and keep coming short of the glory of God. That part's continuous action verb. We have all sinned, but day by day we keep coming short of the glory of God. Again, Jesus is the glory of God. He shows us what the glory of God is. He's God that we can see. He that's seen me has seen the Father, and the glory of God is everything He is. So you and I come short. You know, I might go up to David and try to measure myself by David, or up to Mike and try to measure myself by him. The person you're measured by is Jesus. He alone is the glory of God, and we have come short. Now, let me remind you, if the Bible taught that we're all guilty because Adam sinned, why does Paul take 3 chapters to argue everybody sinned? There is nowhere in the Bible that teaches I'm guilty because Adam sinned. The Bible teaches I die physically because Adam sinned. But no scripture teaches I am guilty of sin because of Adam. That was started by Augustine. That's that little chart I gave you that I'm going to show you all 5 of the points are wrong. Because it's all based on his interpretation of Romans. And he didn't have one person that agreed with him when he taught it. Now, he came on the scene in the 4th century A.D. And does that mean the church didn't preach the truth till the 4th century A.D.? He makes a statement, Augustine was brave enough to teach predestination in one book. Well, why? Because it's not true. God predestines what's going to happen, but not who it's going to happen to. In other words, God has a predestined plan. How many know that? And God knows who's going to be there, but we make the decision whether we're there or not. He predestines what's going to happen to those that are there, but he has foreknowledge about who's going to do it. So he knows if you're going to be there or not, but he doesn't make the decision for you. And the illustration I use, if I could see the whole life of a mouse from there over to here, and there's a big hole here, I would know ahead of time whether he was going to walk through it or walk around it. But he still made the decision. So God never takes away our ability to make a decision. That's why the last message of the Bible in Revelation is, whosoever will, let him come. Whosoever will exercise his or her will. Ellen?
I'm wondering if Augustine picked up these ideas from, Neoplatonism.
Yeah, Neoplatonism, right. And that means from the, it means basically a new form of philosophy based on Plato, who lives in the 4th century B.C., okay? And that's where Augustine got his idea. He was a Platonic philosopher before he became a Christian. And so he came up with all these ideas, and then John Calvin, he came along and systematized it. But the Bible teaches whosoever will. How many know the Bible says God so loved the world that he gave his unique son, that whosoever believes in him will not perish but have everlasting life? So I gave you those 5 points, so we're going to disprove all 5 of them from the Word of God. So we've sinned and keep coming short of the glory of God. Now, I'm 84 years old. I keep saying, God, when are you going to get finished with me? He's still working on me. How do you know he's still working on you? Aren't you glad?
Yes.
Eh? He's still working on us. Paul said, I have not yet apprehended that for which I was apprehended of Christ. And that's on death row. He's in the Philippian jail about to have his head cut off. It's his last book. And so he hadn't made it yet. Now he said, being justified freely by his grace. Justified. You are declared holy and not guilty of ever having sinned by the blood of Jesus Christ. Turn to the person next to you and say, God says you've never sinned. Now, that's not true if you don't know Jesus. That's not true if you don't know Jesus. All right? By the redemption, who God has set forth a propitiation. And that word actually means to buy a slave back from paying a ransom. And that's the basic meaning of redemption in the Bible. Paying the price to free a slave. How many remember when he freed you and set you free by his grace? He paid the price 2,000 years ago. And he wasn't crucified on Friday, he was crucified on Thursday, he was actually crucified on Wednesday, but I won't get into that. But in any event, he rose on the first day of the week. That proved everything he said was true. If you claim it's easy to start a religion like Christianity, go ahead and let someone kill you and come back to life the third day. All right? Alan?
I like what they said about the Buddhist philosopher, about he taught the people, he loved the people.
Yeah. He's mentioning one of our missionaries who was talking to a Buddhist philosopher. I go to Buddhist countries, and they're good people. They have good moral principles. But he's talking to a Buddhist, it was actually a monk, and the Buddhist said, he said, Buddha was born for the people. The missionary said, Jesus was born for the people. He said, Buddha loved the people. He said, Jesus loved the people. He said, Buddha taught the people. He said, Jesus taught the people. He said, Buddha died for the people. He said, Jesus died for the people. And then the missionary said, go on. Go on. Jesus rose again for the people. Okay? Praise God. That's the bottom line. We used to sing, I know he lives because he lives within my heart. How many have met him and know he's alive? Say amen. Religion's dead. Jesus is alive and well. And Paul's dealing a lot with religion in this book. He set forth as a propitiation. He's redeemed you. He bought you back from the slave market. Brought you back. And the big picture of that in the Old Testament is the book of Hosea. God said, go out and marry a daughter of the whoredoms. And he took Gomer to be his wife. And you read Gomer leaves him. And he goes back and he buys her back from the slave market. The same way God says he's going to buy Israel back from captivity. So, why? He set forth through the faith in his blood. Now, the blood represents everything Jesus is. The Bible says in the book of Leviticus, the life of the flesh is in the blood. Without the shedding of blood, there's no remission of sin. I know a medical doctor that got saved reading the book of Leviticus because of the things that were there that we didn't know till the 20th century that were written 1450 B.C., such as the life of the flesh is in the blood. You find the germ theory, quarantine the leper. We didn't know about that till after World War I. They used to do surgery on the same dirty rags. They used over and over the same, over and over again. And the germ theory is there. He knelt down in his living room, accepted Jesus Christ because of the book of Leviticus. He was in our church up in Bad Axe, Michigan years ago. To declare his righteousness for the remission of sins that are past through the forbearance of God. In other words, God doesn't judge every sin instantly. Now, how can God forgive sins in the Old Testament? In verse 26, to announce, to publicly announce his righteousness, that he might be righteous and the one declaring us innocent and holy on them which believe in Jesus. Now, how can he do that with the Old Testament saints? They didn't know anything about Jesus. They didn't know anything about Jesus. But we're going to read here that faith is obedience to God. If you're not obeying God, you don't have any faith. Faith includes obedience to God. Pastor George mentioned it Sunday. He said, if you love me, keep my commandments. And he only gave us a few, not the 10. He only gave us a few. But, and I've told you this illustration before. The Bible in the book of Hebrews says the blood of animals can't take away sin. Yet when Adam and Eve sinned, God took innocent animals and clothed them with skins to hide their sin. And he forgave their sin. When Noah sinned, he built an ark. You know, it's the first thing Noah did when he came out of the ark. He got drunk. And then he cursed his grandson, Canaan. But Noah built an ark. God forgave his sin because he offered a sacrifice. All the way through the Old Testament, person after person brought a sacrifice because God said to do it. They were obeying what God said by faith. If I bring this sacrifice, God's gonna forgive my sins, family, for my family's sin for the past year. If I bring this blood sacrifice. But yet Hebrews says the blood of animals can't take away sin. You know what happened? Because they came by faith. People are saved in the Old Testament by faith just as much as in the New Testament. But they had faith and obeyed the promise of God. But what God did, when Noah here sitting in the second row sinned, he brought the sacrifice and God forgave him, but he put it on a big MasterCard account. Amen. When Jacob and Isaac and Judas and Jude and everybody else sinned, God forgave them when they obeyed, but he put it on a big MasterCard. And 2,000 years ago, the master paid the bill for every person that has ever lived or ever will live when they come to him. That's why God is righteous when he forgives sin, because he knew what he was going to do. Jesus is the lamb slain from before the foundation of the world, the scripture says. So we conclude, well, where is boasting then? Well, I'm going to heaven because I've done this and I've done that and I've done this and I've done that. No, by what law? By works? No, but by the law of faith. We conclude a man is justified, again declared not guilty of ever having sinned, by faith without the deeds of the law. The keeping of the law has nothing to do with salvation. Nothing. And then he asked, is he the God of the Jews only? Is he not also of the Gentiles? Yes, of the Gentiles. How many are glad for that? Well, then, it's one God who will justify the circumcision by faith, the uncircumcision through faith, the Jews and Gentiles. Do we then make void the law through faith? No, we establish the law. How? Because the law points to Jesus. The sacrifices point to Jesus. The law says the seed of the woman's coming is going to crush the head of the serpent. The law, Moses said, there's going to come a prophet like me, and anyone that won't hear him, God's going to judge, referring to Jesus. That was 1,450 years before his birth. The Old Testament, the prophets, he is wounded for our transgressions, bruised for our iniquities. Chastisement of our peace was on him. By his stripes we've been healed. 700 years before his birth in the book of Isaiah. He made his grave with the wicked, plural, crucified between two thieves, and laid in a rich man's tomb in Isaiah. All those years before. So, he's the God of everybody. We don't make void the law, we establish it. Any questions so far? I know I'm going fast tonight on purpose. Okay? Now, chapter 4. Chapter 4. Yes, okay.
This doesn't have anything to do with what you're teaching right now, but a while ago you said...
Okay, I didn't hear. Talk louder.
A while ago you said that Jesus was crucified on a Wednesday.
Could you explain? That'd take all the rest of the night.
Okay.
I will have to say, I'll give you an advertisement. That's in a book, what are the 20 questions on Sunday Night Live?
The most often asked questions on Sunday Live, but I'm out of them. I haven't had the money to get them reprinted. Yeah. So that was one of the questions in my book, the most often asked questions on Sunday Night Live. We did that program for 24 years, by the way, live questions and answers. But tradition, said Good Friday. Just to throw a question out, Jesus said, as Jonah was 3 days and three nights in the heart of the earth, or in the belly of the fish, I'll get it right here, so must the Son of Man be 3 days and three nights in the heart of the earth. Friday crucifixion, how can you have 3 days and three nights if you're resurrected by the time the sun comes up on Sunday morning? You can't have it, all right? And there are people who say, well, it means part of a day. One person even went so far as to say, well, there was an eclipse on one day, so that counts for another day. No, it doesn't. Jesus said, now, either was Jesus wrong or we're wrong. Okay, we're wrong. And what people don't notice is the idea of a Friday crucifixion comes from John's Gospel, where it says they wanted the bodies off the cross because it was preparation for the Sabbath day. And that means the Sabbath day is beginning at 6 o'clock. And yet you read in Mark's Gospel, and some of the translations translate it by tradition rather than what the Greek text says, when the Sabbath was passed, the women bought spices. They went out and bought spices when the Sabbath was passed, okay? Then Luke says they prepared the spices, whatever they had to do in their home, and then they rested on the Sabbath day. There are two Sabbath days. Don't forget, it's Passover season. The first and the last day of the Feast of Unleavened Bread were called High Sabbaths. And John really mentions that. He says the bodies had to be off the cross by the Sabbath day, for that day was a high day. It wasn't the weekly Sabbath. It was the first day of the Feast of Unleavened Bread. So when the first day of the Feast of Unleavened Bread was over, the women bought the spices, then they rested on the weekly Sabbath, and on the dawning of the first day of the week, the tomb was already empty. So Jesus was in the tomb all night Wednesday, all night Thursday, all night Friday, all day Thursday, all day Friday, all day Saturday. Remember the Jewish Sabbath is sundown Friday to sundown Saturday. And so he resurrected sometime after 6 p.m. on Saturday night, which was the first day of the week. Because when the women came, when the sun was coming up, he was already risen. So he's resurrected the first day. It always helps to read the book. Yeah. That's not original with me. That comes from an old book. That was the teaching of the early church. Teaching of the early church. It was the Roman Catholic Church that decided it was Friday. Okay? Okay, we have a question. We have a mic here. Yes. Tradition.
Heretic.
And talk loud. I'm still learning to adjust these things.
Okay. You spoke on the commandments. You said they gave us 10 commandments, but only 3 for us. I didn't understand the whole thing of you said the commandments.
Well, actually, the Ten Commandments.
I only mentioned three that we've broken. We've broken all 10. But the only thing is, we're not under the Ten Commandments anymore. We'll see that in the rest of the book of Romans. Paul is going to point out very closely that the law was abolished. It was done away with. The whole Sinai covenant was done away with on Calvary. And again, the book of Galatians gives 7 arguments to prove that. The book of Hebrews takes 10 chapters to prove it. Even the Jewish Christians aren't under the Sinai covenant. And all 10 of the Ten Commandments were abolished when Jesus died. Now, 9 of them are repeated in different words for the Christian. The only one that's not repeated for the Christian is keeping the Sabbath day. That's the only one that's not repeated for the Christian. Alan?
Also, Jesus said that there are 2 commandments, to love the Lord your God with all your heart, mind, soul, and strength. Love your neighbor as yourself. And yeah. He says, upon these 2 commandments fit all the law and the prophets. That's
right. Yeah. So we'll get back to this in chapter 6, 7, and 8, though. Paul gets into it again in chapter 6. And I'll give you a whole bunch of scriptures showing the law was abolished when Jesus said it is finished. Okay, and the veil of the temple was ripped in 2. So, and now he's going to talk about Abraham. Now, how many have a King James Bible? Okay, you're going to find the word counted, reckoned, imputed. It's all the same word in the Greek text. It means to write something down to your account. It's a word we get about logging information down. Okay? And I hate to admit it, I like the NIV here, but the NIV is the same as it's actually the same as the New American Standard, and it uses the word, it was credited to your account. Now, we understand that better, don't we? You make a payment on your credit card, it's credited to your account. You go and pay a bill, it's credited to your accounts. You deposit a check at the bank, it's credited to your account. What he's going to show us here is righteousness is put down on our account by pure faith. Pure faith. And again, faith is not mental assent to truth. Faith, according to the New Testament, is receiving Jesus Christ and making a commitment of your life to him. Now, what shall we say then? And we talked about Abraham last week. Our father has found pertaining to the flesh. If Abraham was justified by works, he has whereof to glory, but not before God. In other words, I did this and I did this. That's fine, Abraham, it doesn't mean anything. But what does the scripture say? Abraham believed God, and it was credited unto him for righteousness. Now to him that works is a reward not credited of grace, but of debt. But to him that doesn't work, but believes on him that justifies or declares not guilty the ungodly, his faith is credited for righteousness. Even as David describes the happiness of the man unto whom God does not, unto whom God credits righteousness without works. And he's quoting from the 32nd Psalm, saying, happy are they whose iniquities are forgiven and whose sins are covered. How many are glad your sins are covered tonight? And if you could open your book, it would say righteous. If you go to heaven, open your book, it's going to say righteous if you're under the blood of Christ. Not your righteousness, his righteousness. Okay? Happy is the man to whom the Lord will not credit sin. Does the blessing had come on the circumcision or on the uncircumcision also? For we say that faith was credited to Abraham for righteousness. How was it credited unto him? When he was circumcised or uncircumcised? No, not in circumcision, but in uncircumcision. And I pointed out last week, he was declared righteous when he was 85. He was circumcised when he was 99 and made the covenant with God. And that's like baptism. Baptism doesn't save anybody. It's the answer of a good conscience toward God, according to 1 Peter. He receives the sign of circumcision, we can talk about baptism, as a seal of the righteousness of the faith which he had, being yet uncircumcised, that he might be the father of all them that believe, though they be not circumcised, that righteousness might also be credited unto them. And the father of circumcision to them who are not of the circumcision only, but who walk in the footsteps of the faith of our father Abraham. That's a military word. It means to walk in file behind him. Now, it doesn't say walk like Abraham. It says walk in his faith. And we talked about last week how he staggered with faith, how he took things into his own hands, how he lied about Sarah being his sister after God said, I'm your righteousness, you're receiving great reward. Whosoever blesses you, I'm going to bless. Whosoever curses you, I'm going to curse. And he's 100 years, he's 85 years old, and Sarah's 75. And he says, now, Sarah, you better tell them you're my sister. They're going to kill me and take you to be their wife. That faith? No, how many struggle with faith? If you don't cheer up, you will. Cheer up, you will. It's not wrong. It's not wrong. Let me give you an illustration. John the Baptist, the only man in all of history, it says, was filled with the Holy Spirit from his mother's womb. He saw the Spirit come down on Jesus, and he said, I didn't know him, but the one that sent me to baptize told me the one you see the Spirit coming down and remaining, that's my son. He's the one that baptizes with the Holy Spirit. I bear record. This is the Son of God. Woo! Perfect faith. And then John's thrown into prison. And he sends two of his disciples to Jesus. You know what they ask him? Are you really him? After all of that, are you really him? So the enemy will put doubts in your mind, but just remember what God's done for you and what he did for all of us on the cross of Calvary. It's not a sin to doubt. The enemy can drop thoughts into your mind, but focus your mind back on the things of God. And I pick up the sword of the Spirit and say, yeah, but he rose from the dead. Yeah, but he paid the bill for my sin. You know, that's what Jesus did. Prove you're the Son of God. Cast yourself down from the pinnacle of the temple. He has written, you shall not put the Lord your God to the test. No wonder the enemy left him. He took the sword of the Spirit. That's the only offensive weapon we have. Everything else is defensive. The helmet of salvation, the breastplate of righteousness, the shield of faith, your feet shod with the preparation of the gospel of peace. It's all defensive except the sword of the Spirit. So when the enemy comes, use the sword. I didn't mean to get off on that. Now we walk in the faith of Abraham, which wasn't perfect. But again, when the Holy Spirit records it in the New Testament, he can't tell you that. Because Abraham built an altar, and what God forgives, God forgets. We can go back and read it, but the Holy Spirit can't record it when he writes the New Testament. It's under the blood of Christ. For the promise that he should be heir of the world was not to Abraham or his seed through the law, but through the righteousness of faith. If they were to the law be the heirs, faith is made void and the promise meaningless, because the law works wrath. But where the law is, there is no transgression. If there wasn't a 70-mile-an-hour, well, it isn't 70, 65-mile-an-hour sign, and you were going 75, it wouldn't make any difference if that sign wasn't up there. The law says you get a ticket, buddy. But if that sign wasn't up there, they couldn't give me a ticket for going 85. All right? Therefore, it's of faith that it might be by grace. To the end, the promise might be sure to all of the seed, ratified, made stable, not to that which is of the law, but also to that which is the faith of Abraham, who is the father of us all. As it is written, I made you a father of many nations, before whom he believed, even God who makes alive the dead and calls those things which are not as though they were. That means if God gives you a promise, I don't care what it looks like, it is going to happen. It's going to happen. And I've told you many times, when I came here 42 years ago, all my pastor friends said, get that church out of the city. Get out to the suburb. We actually had six Assembly of God churches within 2 miles of this one. They've all gone out to the suburbs. And all my friends said, get the church of the city. God can't build a church in the city. I said, why? I said, suburban people won't drive in. I told them I didn't know only suburban people were important to God. And you see the miracles that God's done here. We had a little building on the corner that would seat about 300 people. God does. God is a miracle-working God, folks. He called it. Who against hope believed in hope. Now, hope is something that's going to happen. You just don't see it happening yet. The hope of the church is the coming of Jesus. But how many know he's coming? Hope is not wishful thinking in the Bible. Like I say, I hope it doesn't rain Sunday. That's not what hope is in the Bible. It's something that's absolutely, positively going to happen. We just don't see it yet. Okay? So a hope, it was going to happen. He believed that he might become the father of many nations, according to that was spoken, so shall your seed be. Now the King James says, if you have it, being not weak in faith, he considered not his own body now dead. The Greek text says he considered his body dead. He knew he was 99 years old. He knew that. And the deadness of Sarah's womb. He knows Sarah, now she was 89. He knew she couldn't have babies either. He considered that. He was realistic in his faith here. When he was about 100 years old, now the deadness of Sarah's womb. But he staggered not through unbelief. Staggered. And in other words, he didn't try to figure it all out. not the promise of God, that was strong in faith, giving glory to God, and fully persuaded that what he had promised he was able to perform. How many of God's able to do what you need to be done? Amen. Persuaded of it. Act on it. Live on it. To him, therefore, it was credited to him for righteousness. Now, it was not written for his sakes alone that it was credited to him, but for us also, whom it shall be credited if we believe on him that raised Jesus for our Lord from the dead, who was delivered for our offenses and raised again for our justification, his transgressions. Two parts of one picture, Ellen.
It seems to me when I read my Bible that Abraham didn't have much faith, though.
He staggered with it, didn't he? But he had enough. Had enough. You don't have to have perfect faith. You listen to some of the evangelists on television. Well, if you're having a hard time, it's lack of faith. Just make a positive confession. That's all. Your words have power. If you believe your words have power, go outside and holler, let there be light. And if you stay out there long enough, it'll happen. Scriptures are pulled out of context. Totally out of context. Totally out of context. The book of Proverbs talks about you're going to be caught in the trap of your words, Alan. But if you read the context, the whole context is if I owe the bank money and he countersigns for me and I can't pay it, he's going to be trapped. He's got to pay it. That's the whole context of that phrase. Because he signs as a surety on a note. Read the context. You can pull scriptures out of context and make them say anything you want them to say. Scripture means what it means in that sentence, in that paragraph, in that book, and it doesn't mean 10 things. It means one. It means one thing. But we like to pull scriptures out and make it say what we want it to say. Y'all still here? Now, I'm going to mess with theologians a bit. I told you this would be equal to an undergraduate class when we started it. And chapter 5, verse 1. Chapter 5, verse 1. Let me turn over. I have my Greek New Testament up here. Okay, chapter 5, verse 1. Now, the King James says, being justified by faith, we have peace with God through our Lord Jesus Christ. Every translation you have says that. Is there any that don't say that you have in your hand? Oh, your Greek doesn't count, Alan. Okay? Now, there's two different readings in the Greek manuscripts. And I want to tell you what people say about this. Is there's two different readings. Now, let me tell you, there are 5,000 plus manuscripts of the Greek New Testament. In the day when the King James was translated, in the year 1611, they had inferior manuscripts. They actually made it from a 12th century Greek book. And since then, the archaeologists have found older manuscripts, and it shows where scribes have made strange mistakes in copying. Not anything critical, but made unusual mistakes. Now, there's two different ways of saying, let us have peace or we have peace. Your King James Bible says, and actually the Greek text says, having been justified by faith or declared not guilty by faith, we have peace with God. The other translation says, let us keep on having peace with God, meaning the possibility of even after you've once had peace, not to have it anymore. Well, even in the Greek New Testament, and let me give you the two words, they're both spelt the same way, E-C-H-O-M-E-N, ekumen. Okay, why don't you say ekumen? Okay, the one we have peace, it has an O in it like O in log. Okay, original Greek has two O's. It has O like we say log or bog or cog. And then it has the omega, which is a long O, show, go, row, okay? And if it's the short omega, it just means we have peace. But if it's the long one, it means we let us keep on having peace. And some of the comments that come out about this, the overwhelming oldest manuscripts say, let us keep on having peace. But that chart I've handed out to you, the 5 points of Calvinism, they believe so strong in unconditional security, they try to explain away any verse that puts question on it. Try to explain it away. And just some of the comments, okay, that scholars have made. And many of you know I'm teaching, you know, the book of Romans in Greek in Burma later this year for fourth year Greek students. Now, here's some of the comments of people. Let me find all these comments. I've got 9 pages of notes here, so I'm I'm only going to read you a couple of them, okay? Well, the Omega, and that's the one that says, let us keep on having faith. One book says it has to be a scribal error. Paul dictated it, and the guy describing it, he got it all mixed up. Because they did that sometimes, they got it all mixed up. And yet when you go back and search history, at that time they never got it mixed up. It's more current history where they do that, in the same way English changes. Here's another one. Although the subjunctive, that's the one with the omega, has far better external support, the majority of the committee judged that, well, Paul is not going to go from exhorting to, he's not going to go from instructing to exhorting. And so he wouldn't have used the subjunctive. Such arguments. It's such arguments. The reason they say that is it messes with their theology if it means let us keep having peace. And let me quote from some other people. The original Old Testament, the original Greek Testament is what we call the Tischendorf, isn't it, Alan?
Yeah.
And he said it can be no other reading but the subjunctive. Any other reading is altogether unacceptable. And then Hodge, on the other hand, a man of strong eternal security, there's no indication that after he's finished his exposition, he started exhorting. In other words, Paul couldn't do that. But let me quote some from some other scholars. I took Greek under Julius Manti at Northern Baptist Seminary. And how many know our good Baptist brothers believe in eternal security? You know, I preach in a lot of Baptist churches. I don't discuss the issue. All right, that they believe no matter what, once you're saved, you live like the devil and you're still saved. Or else they say you weren't really saved in the first place. And I remind them that the prodigal son, when he came back home, the father said, this, my son was dead and is alive again. And I give him some other scriptures too, but I don't debate with my brothers. I don't debate. I respect my brothers in Christ. I've got Christian friends that say we're going through the rapture. I say, according to your faith, be it unto you, but I'm not. Okay. This was Northern Baptist Seminary. At the time when I took Beginning Greek, the second year textbook was by Dana and Manti, and Julius Manti was one of the professors. It was a standard second year textbook all over the world. And he asked the question, which is right in Romans 5, the subjunctive, which means let us keep having faith, or the indicative, let us have faith? Well, I knew that he believed in unconditional eternal security, being a good Southern Baptist. But I wrote in my paper, I don't believe it's right to overlook the overwhelming manuscript evidence because it disagrees with our theology. And I got the answer back on my paper, either do I, A plus. Right? But you have to overlook the overwhelming manuscript evidence. A.T. Robertson. Now, A.T. Robertson was the Greek professor. He wrote a book on grammar that thick and that big, the grammar of the Greek New Testament. In the light of historical research. He is the professor of a previous day to this. He says this, let us keep having peace with God. This is the correct text. The present active subjunctive, not ecumen, of the Textus Receptus. That's what the King James was made from. It's curious how perverse many scholars have been with this word and phrase here. One only has to observe the force of the tense to see Paul's meaning clearly. The mode is the volitive subjunction, and the present expresses linear action. Now again, A.T. Robertson was president of the Southern Baptist Convention. But he says this is what the Greek text says. The premier scholar in the world today that we all look up to is Gordon Fee. Okay? Gordon Fee says this, let us keep on enjoying peace. Let us retain peace with God. And he makes the following statement. There are those that on the basis of the context demands the executive, the indicative. Well, it seems to be a polite way of saying that scholars have difficulty believing that Paul would argue differently than themselves. They so believe that, they're willing to change the Greek text to make it say we have peace instead of let us keep having peace. Now again, these are good brothers. And how many know you can disagree without being disagreeable? I don't know if you know, they had a preterist conference here in Kansas City 2 years ago, and those are the folks who believe all prophecy ended in 70 AD. There's no more prophecy. I was the only non-preterist speaker, and we had to answer questions. First he would answer, then I would answer. We didn't debate with each other, but we took opposite sides of the questions, and we still have great respect for each other. I wrote a big article for the churches in off of the churches in Singapore before I went last year about a 10-page article. Because it was one church decided we were going through the tribulation and called everybody else in town heretics. Now, Singapore has more big churches than any city in the world per capita. There's 5.5 million people in an area smaller than Kansas City. They have more huge churches. Most of them are Assemblies of God or Baptist. And he was making this big issue. So I wrote an article for their newspaper. They have a Christian newspaper. We can disagree without being disagreeable. And we have many good brothers and sisters that hold other opinions. We'll all know when we get to heaven, won't we? But until then, we look at the scripture the best we can. Ellen?
I'm wondering also, a lot of Paul's books, he teaches teachings and then starts immediately exhorting the people.
Yeah, right, immediately exhorting. He does that all the time.
Galatians, Ephesians, all of them.
Right. If you don't know, Alan has a degree in biblical languages, a master's degree in biblical languages. That's why we give him a mic. I need somebody to straighten me out sometimes. What'd you say? I'm a heretic? Yes.
I heard one of our prominent ministers today talking about eternal security, and he brought up the fact that people believe that if you think that you can walk away from God, he said what you'll end up doing is running into divine discipline. Could you explain what that means?
Well, I disagree with him. I disagree with him 100%. There's so many scriptures in the Bible. In the book of Galatians, Paul says, you think you're made perfect by the law, you're fallen from grace. And that's people that have been saved by faith. And then when you go, now God's able to keep us. The emphasis is God's able to keep us. I believe in eternal security, but not unconditional eternal security. How many know you still have a free will? You can still do what you want to do. And again, the prodigal son started out at home. When he came back, he said, this my son was dead and is alive again. But let me, you look at the parable of the sower. And Jesus taught that some of the seed grows for a while. And the cares of this life and the deceitfulness of riches and the lust of other things choke it out and it dies. Paul says in Colossians chapter 1, he will present us holy and unblameable, and I translated unnitpickable in his sight, if we continue in the faith, grounded and settled, and be not moved away from the hope of the gospel. Now he's writing to Christians, not to the unsaved. Look over at 1 Corinthians chapters 9 and 10. 1 Corinthians 9 and 10. Because all of this goes back to Augustine's assumption. God is absolutely sovereign. Okay? Therefore, he predestines who's going to be saved. When he calls you, he calls you by irresistible grace. You have to come. And the only reason you can come, you were born a dirty, rotten, filthy sinner. And because you were born a dirty, rotten, filthy sinner, you can't choose to come to God if you want to. And therefore, you're eternally secure. Those 5 points. But again, it was Augustine, the 4th century, that came up with those. And the church did not believe that. His friends didn't believe that. And actually, the statement's made, his friends were Pelagian. I'll explain that later. And he was brave enough, bold enough to preach predestination. Well, he was wrong. And I just want to show you why. We have a choice whether we're going to serve God or not. Now, you make your mind to serve God, there's not a devil in hell can stop you. There's not a person can stop you if you make up your mind. And how many know he's able to keep you? But if you decide you want to walk away, he's given you a free will. And so many scriptures warn us about that. One author said, these things are in the New Testament in case this could happen, but it can't happen. Then why did God put it here if it can't happen? But believes eternal security so strong, it's here in case it could happen, but it can't happen. Let's look at Hebrews chapter 9. And actually, the chapter division should be in verse 24, chapter 9. 1 Corinthians chapter 9. 1 Corinthians chapter 9. And chapter 9 should be, chapter 10 should begin at verse 24 of Ephesians. Don't forget the chapter divisions were added in the Middle Ages. Don't you know that they which run in a race all run, but only one gets the gold medal? Okay, in their days it was a laurel wreath. Keep running that you may obtain. Every man that strives for the games is self-controlled in all things. Now they do it to obtain a corruptible crown, which is the laurel wreath, but we an incorruptible crown. I therefore keep running. Not as uncertainly, so fight I, not as one that beats the air, but I keep under my body, I bring it into subjection, lest by any means when I preach the rules to others, I myself should be disqualified. And the word is adokimos, that is usually translated reprobate in your New Testament. Paul is indicating that he could be disqualified for heaven. He's not talking about his ministry being set on a shelf. Read the context. Now he goes on to explain this. Moreover, brothers, I don't want you to be ignorant how our fathers were under the cloud. They all passed through the sea. They were baptized into Moses in the cloud and in the sea. In other words, they followed him. They did all eat the same spiritual meat. They did all drink the same spiritual drink, for they drank of the spiritual rock that followed them. That rock was Christ. Nevertheless, with many of them, God was not well pleased. They were overthrown in the desert. Now, these things were our examples. Who? Us, we Christians. To the intent that we should not lust after evil things as they lusted. That's from Numbers 11. Don't be idolaters, as were some of them, as it was written, the people sat down to eat, drink, and rose up to play, Exodus 32. Neither let us commit fornication, as some of them committed and fell in one day, 23,000, Numbers chapter 25. Neither let us tempt Christ, as some of them tempted were destroyed of serpents, Numbers chapter 21. Don't murmur, I like the Greek word murmur, gangustes. as some of them also gangustes and were destroyed of the destroyer. All right, and that's Numbers 14. Now, all these things happen unto them for examples. They are written for our admonition, upon whom the ends of the age are come. Therefore, let him that thinks he stands take heed lest he fall. There's no temptation in you, but such as is common to man. But God is faithful, who will not allow to be tempted above what you're able, but make a way. He will, with the temptation, make a way of escape that you may be able to bear it. Therefore, flee from idolatry. These are written for our example. They started out for Cain, and they didn't make it because of sin. And it's a warning to us, Paul says. Now, why put that in here if it can't happen? Okay, how many believe God says things that can't happen? Yeah. Okay, can we have a mic down here, please? And talk loud because we want the people on watching on TV to hear too.
Were they under grace? Because we're under grace now, so
we're under grace, but the New Testament's written to people under grace. I'm reading from the New Testament. We're not under the law.
Well, I know, but they didn't make it to Canaan, but they weren't under grace either. But we
do. But Paul says it's an example to us. He said, "Beware you." He's writing to us. He says it's written for our teaching.
I understand that, but still we fail.
Well, we're saved by grace. But if I turn around and decide I want to go back in the world and live like the devil, I'm not saved anymore.
Well, isn't it a continuance, like hardening of your heart, like you have to continually say...
Well, eventually. It's not a one-time thing. It's a practice of sin. And I'll read this. He warns us in Hebrews about the practice of willful sin. And it doesn't happen overnight. You're not walking on a slippery tightrope. He's able to keep us, isn't he? Paul says, I know whom I believe, and I'm persuaded he's able to keep my deposit against that day. Jesus said, my Father gave you the mighty and all, and no man can pluck you out of my Father's hand. Now, Brother Chuck Wolf was in here and standing with a bug in his hand and say, no man is able to pluck this bug out, I wouldn't argue with him. If you don't know Chuck, he heads our internal security. He's the world's ex-light heavyweight kickboxing champion, and he's about as big as a truck. And so I don't think any of us would argue with him. No one can pluck you out of the Father's hand. If you had a bug here, there's nothing to stop that little bug from flying away. Now, let me give you some other scriptures first, Ellen. Look at the book of Hebrews, chapter 3. Hebrews, chapter 3. Well, let's talk about chapter 2. Now, these are writing to Christians. Therefore, we ought to give the more earnest heed to the things which we have heard, lest at any time we drift away from them. Now, he's writing to Christians, not non-Christians. If the word spoken by angels was steadfast, and every transgression and disobedience receives the just recompense of reward, how shall we escape if we neglect so great a salvation? How shall we escape, us Christians, if we neglect it? Now look at Hebrews chapter 3. He calls them, first of all, holy brothers in verse 1, sharers of the heavenly calling. Now, how many of you know Jesus? Okay, then you're sanctified and holy in God's sight, right? That's the meaning of the word sanctified. God has rendered you holy. The word translated saints in the Bible means holy ones, hagioi. Hagios is holy, hagioi is holy ones. That's the word translated saints in your Bible. Every Christian is holy because you have been rendered holy. The verb is hagiadzo, rendered holy by the blood of Jesus Christ. Okay? So he's writing to holy brothers, sharers of the heavenly calling. Now he goes down in verse 7, says this. Wherefore, today, if you will hear his voice, harden not your hearts, as in the testing, in the day of testing in the desert, where your fathers tempted me, proved me, and saw my works 40 years. I was disgusted with that generation and said, they do always err in their hearts and have not known my ways. I swear in my wrath they shall not enter into my rest. Take heed, brothers. Who are the brothers? Holy brothers, share the heavenly calling. That includes you ladies too. I mentioned that last week. All right? Lest there be in any of you an evil heart of unbelief in apostatizing from the living God. Apostasy means leaving him and no longer believing in him. So it's now why would God put that here if it couldn't happen? And then one author says that can only happen to Jewish Christians because this is the book of Hebrews.
Come back?
Usually if they become an apostate, they don't. They can walk away. Backslider is someone that's just away from God, like the prodigal son. The apostate has reached the place where he no longer believes Jesus is right. So the difference being the big difference between being an apostate and a backslider. The prodigal son we'd call a backslider. He still knew the way back. He still knew his father was what he needed. So a backslider can still know they need God. Like the prodigal son, this my son was dead and is alive again. But the apostate no longer believes that's the way of salvation.
So your conscience would be seared at that point where your heart would be so hard that you would be like,
you wouldn't want to come back. I've met apostates. I've met apostates that said, yeah, I used to thought I knew Jesus Christ. I believed in him, but I know it's all phony now. That person is an apostate. And they cannot come back. Okay? As long as you're in that position. So, and he warns again about the apostate in chapter 6 of Hebrews. Hate clocks, old boy. Therefore, leaving the ABCs of the doctrine of Christ, let's go on to perfection. And then he says in verse 4, it's impossible for those who were once enlightened, have tasted of the heavenly gift, and were made sharers of the Holy Spirit, and have tasted the word of God, good, and the powers of the world to come, good, and fell away, to renew them again to repentance, seeing they keep on crucifying the Son of God afresh and keep putting him to an open shame. That's Hebrews chapter 6. Now again, he's talking about the apostate. Hebrews chapter 10 says, if we keep practicing willful sin after we've received the personal, intimate, relationship, knowledge of the truth, there remains no longer a sacrifice for sin, but a certain fearful looking for of judgment and fiery indignation that shall devour the adversary. He that despised Moses' law died without mercy under two or three witnesses of how much sore punishment shall he be thought worthy, who has trodden underfoot the Son of God, has counted the blood of the covenant wherewith he was sanctified an unholy thing, and then despite to the Spirit of grace, it's written, vengeance is mine, I'll repay, says the Lord. But the emphasis is on the fact he's able to keep you. As long as you want to be kept, he will keep you by his power. Again, you're not on some kind of a slippery tightrope. But the damaging teaching about this, though, the other way, Calvinism, is the fact, well, you went to an altar when you're 4 years old and you're living like the devil now and you're still saved. No, you're not. No, you're not. The Bible makes it very clear. You can't live this lifestyle and stay saved. And all we like sheep, well, that's how we've all gone astray. So I'll be reading chapter 5. I thought I'd get a little bit further than that tonight. But they're even willing to translate the Greek text wrong because it disagrees with their theology. They so believe that. And I like what Gordon Fee said, that Paul would argue different than them is unthinkable to them. And, Gordon Fee is the premier scholar in the world today. And I know Gordon, and we need to pray for him. They say he's got Alzheimer's. And he's such a tremendous man. I met him in Brussels several years ago. He and I were teaching at the same school. And he's just a tremendous, tremendous man. I think I have in my library everything he's written. and I find authors I like and I keep them. I hang on to them. Most authors, I read the book, I've read it. That's it. And I usually give it away. But some of them I like to hang on to. But the main thing is God's able to keep us. But I'm trying to show that those 5 points, they all agree within themselves, but there's too many other scriptures that disagree with them. Now, God is sovereign, but doesn't the Bible teach all the way through we have a free will? We make the choice. Choose you this day who you will serve, Joshua told the people. As for me and my house, we're going to serve the Lord. You've got the choice. And God will never take away that ability to choose. That's why when he put Adam and Eve in the Garden of Eden, he gave them a choice. Eat of the tree or don't eat it. Of course, Satan came along. Yeah, hadn't God said you can eat of all the trees of the garden? First, he questioned what God said. Secondly, he flatly denied what God said. You're not going to die. Thirdly, God's an old meanie, Eve. You're going to be like him, and he doesn't want you to be like him. Go ahead and do it. The woman saw the tree was good for food, pleasant to the eye, tree to be desired to make a wow! And then Adam. Adam, the first time he saw Eve, I can imagine. I imagine the first time I couldn't study in front of that bouncy little 4'10" girl. Couldn't study. And God gave me almost 60 years with her. And imagine the first time he saw Eve. Wow. Here's one like me, but different. Wow. Whew, she's bone of my bone and flesh of my flesh. In Hebrew, he is Ish and she is Ashah. He is Adam, she is Adamah. Whoo! Then sin came. That woman, the one you gave me. The enemy's good at that. It's not my fault. Not my fault. Aaron made the golden calf. Moses comes down from Mount Sinai. I said, what have you done? Well, I threw the gold in the fire. Out came the calf. Read it. Yeah. Not my fault. Saul, you kill, destroy the Amalekite. What made the bleeding of the sheep? Well, the people wanted to keep them alive. To offer a sacrifice. Hear God. Obedience is better than sacrifice. Obedience is better than the fat of ram. Because you've rejected the word of the Lord, he's rejected you from being king. It's always somebody else's fault. It's my fault when I sin, nobody else's. You can't blame anybody else but you because you have a free will. Okay? But thank God he paid the bill for it all. Praise God. Let's give the Lord a hand for his grace. So read Romans chapter 5 and 6 and 7 and 8. Now we'll spend a lot of time in 6, 7, and 8. And a lot of time in the rest of 5. And look all through the scriptures except at Romans 5 and Psalm 51. I dare you to find a scripture that says we're tainted by or guilty of Adam's sin. And like Calvinists say, well, I'm not guilty of Adam's sin. I'm only guilty of my own sin, whether I did it myself or whether I did it in Adam. People say, well, it's only because of sin that people die. So that shows you were born guilty of Adam's sin. Then why does my pet puppy die? Was he born guilty of Adam's sin? Do you think my pet puppy can sin? Or your pet bird can sin? Or your pet turtle or fish can sin? No. Physical death passed upon people, not spiritual death. We'll talk about that in the next couple of weeks. Bow your heads with me, please. Father, we're so thankful for your love and your amazing grace. Thankful that you love each one of us as if we're the only ones you ever had to love. And if we'd have been the only ones that sinned, Jesus would have died for each one of us. I pray if there's anyone here tonight that doesn't know you, draw them by your Holy Spirit just because you love them. You didn't come into the world to condemn the world, but that the world through you might be saved. So draw by your Holy Spirit. I wonder as every head is bowed and every eye closed, do you know Jesus? I'm not asking if you want to join this church. We're not the way to heaven. Jesus Christ is the only way. He says, I'm the way, the truth, and the life, and nobody comes to the Father but by me. The Bible says, as many as receive him, he gives power to become the children of God. The Bible says, he that has the Son has life, and he that doesn't have the Son does not have life. And we're going to read in Romans 8, if Jesus Christ is living in your heart, you know it. The Holy Spirit is bearing witness with your spirit. You're a child of God. So maybe you're here tonight and you're not sure you're saved. Again, I'm not asking you to join this church. But I'm be honest enough to say, Pastor, I'm not sure I know Jesus. I need Jesus Christ to come into my heart tonight. I need to know him myself. Just slip your hand up and down. Anyone at all, God bless you. How many others? God bless you. God bless you. Father, I pray you continue to draw by your Spirit in Jesus' name. Amen. Give me one more minute. Stand with me, please. I need some altar workers, men and women. Jesus said, if you confess me before men, I'll confess you before my Father in heaven. I was in a service like this when I was 19, a baptized church member, but I didn't know Jesus. And that night I stepped out of my seat, a man led me in a prayer, and Jesus Christ changed my life. I need some lady elder workers, please. We're our lady elder workers. Okay, good. If and that night they led me to prayer, and Jesus Christ changed my life. And we've seen him do that so many thousands of times here in this church. So if you need Jesus Christ, I'm going to ask you to do what I did. Just step out of your seat and let someone pray with you. Jesus Christ will change your life tonight. So I'm going to ask each of you to turn to the person next to you. And again, you won't be joining this church by coming. It's got nothing to do with church membership. It has to do with a relationship with a living God that loves you as if you're the only one he ever had to love. So turn to the person next to you and say, if you want to go down and pray, I'll go with you. Go ahead. Go ahead. Make sure everybody has that said to them. If you want to go down and pray, I'll go with you. I'll go with you. Praise God. Praise God. God will change your life tonight. I saw some hands. It's up to you. It's up to you. The enemy's trying to tell you no, and God is saying yes. It's him knocking at the door of your heart. Praise God. Okay, who else is God talking to? Who else is God talking to? Anyone else? Okay, the altar workers will stay here. God bless you. We'll bring somebody with you Easter Sunday and be reading Romans. Okay, you can lead her in prayer. Praise God.